We will ask you to please come back. This is going to be the last portion of today's meeting, our day number one of the annual meeting. Yeah. Okay. I hope you enjoy the break and the coffee. Did you try those warm cookies over there? Those were great. Yeah, David. Yeah, go ahead. Just go crazy. Yeah, those were great. Okay, thank you so much. So again, this is going to be the last part of day one of the annual meeting. So stay with me. I know some of you are tired, but I'm sure you will find many useful things to take back home from the excellent presentations that we had today. So my name is Pablo Aquino. I am the secretary of the ALS Association of Argentina. I am also a member of the board of directors of the International Alliance. I will be your moderator for the last part of today's programming. So we'll begin with Paul Wicks, our first speaker, and his presentation on ALS MND and Wikipedia. Thank you, Paul. It's virtual.
Hi, my name is Paul Wicks, and I am an ALS researcher for the past 20 years, and also for the past 10 years or so, I've been a caregiver to a close family member diagnosed with a condition. I'm going to talk to you today about an online resource that's probably very familiar to many of you, which is Wikipedia, but we're really going to have a deep dive on the potential for improving the system, not just for people living with ALS, but for the broader community among whom we're always trying to raise awareness. We're going to take a really global perspective here, as is appropriate for the International Alliance, to try and understand what can be done to improve the quality and coverage of information in the area in which you work. If you have any questions after this talk, please feel free to drop me an email at the details below. So what is Wikipedia? As you're probably familiar, it is a free online encyclopedia that can be edited freely by just about anybody. If you identify that something is wrong on Wikipedia, you can be annoyed about it, or you can fix it. And the ethos of the site is that you should be bold and make edits and get involved. It's a very commonly used website. It's the seventh most visited website on the whole internet. And as a result, it comes up very high in search engine rankings. We've been seeing that it's been used a lot by AI chatbots. So for example, if you ask a question about ALS, you may well be given an answer by a chatbot like Bing or ChatGPT that contains elements that are familiar from the Wikipedia page on the topic. It's much bigger than a traditional encyclopedia. If you had those Encyclopedia Britannica in your dining room or something like that, then Wikipedia would be thousands of those volumes. So it's nearly 7 million articles about anything you can possibly think of. It has no private funding, so it's funded entirely by donations from its users and is run by a foundation. And we've seen it become, over the past few years, a key resource for a variety of stakeholders. So one example here would be journalists. If someone doesn't know a lot about ALS and they've been asked to investigate a story, I can guarantee you one of the first places they're going to look is the Wikipedia articles. And so if that information is correct, the story will be correct. If it's not, it won't. We also see lots of its use showing up in medical students' dissertations, their essays, their homework even. And so if we want to have the opportunity to train the next generation of people who are going to fight this condition, it's very important this information is of high quality. So let's look specifically at the ALS article on Wikipedia. And I would encourage you, if you're watching this online, please feel free to pause this video and bring up a browser tab and look for the ALS page on Wikipedia. I'm going to be talking about English at first, so have a look there, which is en.wikipedia.org, and then we're going to talk about other languages later on. So the first article about ALS was initially fleshed out in about 2006, and because it was written by a non-specialist, as you can imagine, it sort of lent on other sources, so places like the NIH's information about ALS, or books, or a few articles that were available at the time. But one of the challenges is, because it's entirely run by amateurs and volunteers for the most part, people lack access to the recent scientific literature. And they may not be medically or scientifically trained. They may just be sort of trying to copy in data they find from other places. So relative to information sources like a large nonprofit like the ALS Association or other forms of commercial websites that have data available about diseases like WebMD, for example, you might think Wikipedia is relatively low level in terms of its attention, but there's a few things that have changed in the past few years that have really changed that. So one is, you may remember, the Ice Bucket Challenge from 2014. And one of the things that happened during that challenge is it was going viral on YouTube and people were saying that they were going to donate their money to ALS. But of course, lots of people in the broader space than where we work don't know what ALS is. And so one of the first places they look to is Wikipedia. And so we can see that whilst on average, the English Wikipedia page about ALS was being read about 3,000 times per day. During the peak of the Ice Bucket Challenge, that went up to nearly 500,000 people in a single day, all reading that information. Just to put the numbers into perspective, you know, we think there are something like 400,000 people living with ALS at any one time on planet Earth. Obviously, there's a much larger number of people who are caregivers, who are researchers, who might be interested in conditions, who might be friends, for example. But just the English article alone has been viewed 1,000,000 times in the past 12 months. Okay, so that's about 3,000 times a day, just in English. And we do see spikes from time to time. There's a view page views system that you can use within the history of each page. And we can see particular spikes in interest that track along with events that might be happening in the news. So if a celebrity or a sports person or something like that is diagnosed or sadly dies as a consequence of ALS, we see a lot more inbound traffic. So one example of this would be when Sandra Bullock's husband very sadly passed away as a consequence of ALS, we saw an extra 100,000 views for the Wikipedia page. And as you can imagine, these are probably people who we are trying to reach, that we are trying to educate, because they didn't know what that was. They didn't know what it stood for. And so coming to that page might be someone's first and maybe even their only contact with knowing more about the condition. So, like I say, it's been edited over the years by a variety of amateurs. I have taken a very keen interest. I think I'm the second most involved person on the project in terms of edits and contributions. I have worked as a professional in the space for a number of years in academia and in industry. But it's important to say that, you know, I don't have any special rights or privileges. Anyone can come and delete what I've said or edit it or improve it. And it's very much a consensus-based process of upgrading the articles. However, we have had a lot of developments over the past year or two. So we've had the approval of new therapies, gene therapies, for example, in the United States. There's been an awful lot of research around genetics that's been very interesting. And something that I spotted around late 2022 was that the updates weren't coming through quickly enough and that there was a lot of misinformation still, or vague information on the system. So I made it a personal goal at the beginning of 2023 to try and get the ALS page in English on Wikipedia to a good article status. So what is a good article? Well, this is something that is assessed. It is a peer reviewed by a committee at Wikipedia, essentially. And it confirms that an article is well written. So it's clear that it's factually accurate and very important that it's verifiable. So nearly every sentence that you see needs to have a citation, and ideally those citations should be to high-quality evidence like meta-analyses or systematic reviews. They shouldn't just be a collection of, well, this paper said this in mice, or this paper said this in cells, and here's this clinical trial, right? That's not that helpful for getting a good sense of what's going on. It should be broad in coverage. It should be neutral, so not trying to push an agenda. It should be stable, so not having lots of people argue about it. It should have illustrations, and I'll show you a couple of those in a moment. And if you go through all those hoops and you get through that review, then this puts you in the top 0.7% of all those millions of articles. And it means that when something's a good article, it's also eligible to be included in educational projects around the world where Wikipedia might be given out on laptops or CD-ROMs or other media than just the website that you can see. So here's an example. There were lots of changes in the text, but that's quite hard to illustrate. So just to show you an example of some of the images that are clearer to see. Before this push on improving the article, the top image on the ALS Wikipedia page was this. Do you know what this is? It's not entirely clear to me. It's an enhanced T2 signal on an MRI, apparently, on the corticospinal tract. Now, if you don't happen to know how to read an MRI and know that this is a sideways view of someone, that's not that helpful. So with the help of some colleagues around the world who helped me to develop this illustration, this has now been replaced with a much clearer and colorblind friendly diagram of the way in which ALS affects the body. And so this is the key image at the top of the page that people see. Similarly, before this push, we saw an older version of this diagram trying to give you a cross-section of the brain. But if you look closely, you might see some errors. So for example, that's not the primary motor cortex. It's a little bit too far back. You might see there's no interneurons here. And you might see, well, this is a bit confusing, this little muscle thing. If you don't happen to know that's what a cell looks like, how would you know? So that's been replaced with this much more human cross-section of how things would work. And it's been checked with a number of neurologists and researchers to ensure that it's accurate. And it's hopefully through changes like this that will improve the quality of the education, the learning for everyone that comes to visit the article. So what does the anatomy of a good article look like? Well, as I said, it goes into detail just on ALS. We've broken out other pages for some of the mimic disorders or some of the other motor neuron diseases. These little citations here should take you out to good recent systematic reviews. The English is about as clear as we can make it, although sometimes people are coming in and still tweaking the punctuation. These high quality diagrams are available, and they're freely available for you to use under Creative Commons. Anyone can use them in the way that they've been developed and licensed. And so I'm very pleased to say that in around the summer of 2023, the Wikipedia page on ALS was rated as a good article. So I was very pleased about that. But as is the way with people that work in the space, we get very satisfied with achieving a goal for about 30 seconds. And then we think, what's next? So what's next is other languages. So this page exists in 64 languages. Quite a lot of languages, everything, you know, some more common worldwide languages of European origin, things like Spanish and French and German, but also a variety of less common European languages, a variety of dialects from the Middle East, Asia, Pacific region, et cetera, et cetera. Well, why is that a big deal? Well, surely everyone can read English, or surely everyone can use Google Translate. Well, I can't read most of these languages, but I decided to drill in on three of the languages at which I was reasonably confident that Google Translate could do a good job. So if you only look at German, Spanish, and French, and clearly these are spoken all around the world, not just in Europe, if you add them together, it's about another million views a year, right? And one of the challenges is that although the English page has had a lot of work done to it to make it come up to date, the other languages have not. So they're much shorter. They have the outdated images or no images at all. Their references might be 5, 10, even 20 years out of date. They contain a few facts that are just straight out wrong. So they may omit information, like around cognition, or they may state something falsely and say something like ALS never involves pain or never involves behavioral change. And I think those would be very concerning pieces of misinformation if we saw them in other contexts. And so I think there's no reason they should be permitted to continue here. We also see things that are just not up to date in terms of what treatments are available, right? So we've got 5 approved treatments, at least in the United States. I think it'd be important to know about that in a variety of settings, because of course people might not we don't know what country people are viewing these things from. So I think there's, you know, a great opportunity to improve upon the status of the information. And if these are some of the most common languages with many, you know, people available to speak to them, what must it be like for those other folks? So why am I telling the Alliance about this? Well, look, I hope that we have a shared goal here, that we want to make sure there's high quality information that is free for everyone everywhere, that can be relied upon and serve as a reference point for people as they go on their journey with ALS. So I have a couple of different ways that we could approach this, and I'll certainly welcome further discussion. So the simplest thing to do is, sadly, to not use the languages other than English for now, because we just can't be assured of their quality and their veracity and that they're up to date. So for now, if you have any links or things like that, I would recommend you update those to be to the English article and to encourage use of translation tools. For example, Google Chrome as a browser has a translation tool within it that I think is pretty good. And that will probably get us a little way there. If we agree this is more of a problem and that there are some cultural or linguistically specific things that we should try and develop to ensure that there's more specific pages for different countries or different regions or different dialects, then actually what we might need is to develop a task force that maps these out and tries to prioritize them based on the volume of people using them or places where there's particular unmet need. The good news is there are some automatic translation tools, and I'll show you those in a moment, so you don't have to have human translators doing this all from scratch. There are ways to sort of bring across the good article into your local language and then just sort of tweak it. And then finally, you know, whatever we do, this will become an ongoing process, right? So as we find new genes or as new treatments are available or whatever it is, we actually need this to be maintained. We need this work that goes on here to be shared broadly amongst the community with people with time and training and attention and resources to continue working on this. And it requires continual refreshing and checking. So like I said, there are automatic translation tools available for it. So for example, that once you've done a little bit of training on Wikipedia, you'll be able to access this automatic translation tool. And so what you can see on the left is the English good article. And with just the click of a button, we've been able to translate it to French in a second. Now, the French is not perfect. And so that's why we would need to enlist the help of people who speak both languages fluently to ensure we could tweak and make sure that everything's up to date. But I think that can really get us a long way down the path to our goal of great quality information available for everybody. Like I say, I'm happy to take any questions. Feel free to drop me an email. And thanks so much for your attention.
Thank you, Paul. That was really interesting. And I have 3 minutes for questions. Do we have anything on the live chat? Or maybe here? Question over there.
All right, I got in time this time. So two questions. The first is that there are so many different names for ALS, and like in that French translation, I didn't see maladie de Charcot, which I was told is a more common name for it in France, or at least a name. So I wanted to know more about how that's addressed. And then also, is there any kind of cross-referencing or mutual updating between languages? So, or does every, if you make a change in the English version, every other language has to be manually cross-referenced to update that information, and vice versa, if there's new information from elsewhere?
Yeah, great questions. So there are synonyms listed, and maladie de Charcot is certainly one of them. I think in that translation, it's probably coming up as SLA rather than ALS, but there will be a section down at the bottom that sort of clarifies those different things. And unfortunately, the way Wikipedia works is there isn't that sort of automatic mutual updating going on. And I think there are reasonable reasons for that. You know, different languages and different cultures might have different interpretations of certain historical facts, for example. So yeah, that's just the situation at the moment. But I do hope that, you know, what we might be able to do is do some sprints where we coordinate or we find a small group of volunteers where we could sort of upgrade the quality of, say, the top five languages in one big run, and then maybe come and refresh looking at them every year or 2 years or every time a new drug comes out. So I don't think it's not an unlimited amount of work. It's a finite amount of work, but it might require a little bit of coordination.
I think we do have time for one more question. It has to be short. No, just kidding. But you?
Okay. One of the biggest criticisms of Wikipedia is that apparently anybody can update any entry at any time. And for a page as important as this one, what do you do? What is your protocol for making sure that everything is accurate, given that level of openness?
Yeah, so that is in the DNA of the system. It does have quite a good immune system. So what I mean by that is if someone just registered this morning, they can't delete the page. If someone goes in and says, for example, sadly, there's vandalism, and people will say, you know, ALS is caused by meatballs or something. That will usually be corrected in minutes. So it is not a perfect system by any means, but just to say that it is a community, it is an ecosystem. And what I'm sort of hoping for is that a broader cross-section of the community can participate in its development. And really it's that you know, fact that it can be edited by anyone, which is the way that it got to this place in the first place. But, you know, I just encourage people to think, you know, if you are in contact via your websites and your leaflets with hundreds or a thousand people in a year or something like that, just the volume of people who may be not directly affected in our community, but are in the periphery, are really the ones coming there. So, you know, have a look for yourself, have a look in your own native language, see what you think, have a look if you're, you know, bilingual or multilingual, see what you think. I'm currently in England, as you can tell, as there's my dad's hobby train set behind me. I will be in Basel from Tuesday morning. I'll be on the Sano Genetics booth, or look for someone slightly more smartly dressed than this, but happy to speak with people if they're interested in developing in other languages over the next year.
Kathy, you have a question?
I do have a question, and I actually thought your question was going to go this way. Paul, when you were talking about the statistics around the time of the Ice Bucket Challenge 10 years ago, I'm interested to know, and we've done a little bit of research on this, you looked at it as the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge and how that spiked. But you live in the UK, and I assume there it was called the MND Ice Bucket Challenge. Was there also a spike around the acronym MND or other language differentiators, or was it simply known as the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge?
Yeah, Kathy, that's a great point. We did look at that in the 2014 paper, and even in the UK, it was called the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge. I'm British, as you can tell. I think it's time we put to bed the multiple different languages and essentially, you know, go with the one that is going to be most informative. You know, the internet has eaten the information space. If we all wanted to be called ALS, it's probably going to be most helpful for people to find that information. And I appreciate that neuron with an E or without an E has been a big enough issue over the past 34 years. So I don't mean to say this wouldn't be simple to solve. But ultimately, if we want to engage with people who don't want to go and learn about the ins and outs of this, we have to be more consistent in the way that we're presented. And if we are Lou Gehrig's disease and we're ALS and we're mentioning neuron disease with an E and without an E, we're not helping ourselves. So I feel like this is a sign that, yes, people did not search for the MND Ice Bucket Challenge in anywhere near, but less than 1% of the frequency that they did the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge. And I think that's a signal that we should interpret and react to.
Okay, thank you so much, Paul.
Thank you.
Okay, so up next, please welcome Raquel Barajas Azpileta. My Spanish accent is really strong. For her presentation, the way Luzon Foundation supports research. Thank you, Raquel.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Raquel. I'm from Luzon Foundation in Spain. And I don't think it's necessary, but I wanted to start here with some facts about ALS that I think everyone here already knows. But ALS is a very complex disease. We don't know the causes of ALS, and there's no diagnostic or treatment. So what can we do for this? And the answer is research. So I'm here today to talk about the way Luzon Foundation supports research. And I divided my talk in these different topics: basic and clinical research, patient registries, scientific conferences and events, information, advice. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. but before all this, I wanted to bring us all to the same page. And I'm going to show you in each slide for each topic, on the left side, what the need is. On the right side, what we do and how we do it. So for basic research, we economically support basic research. As we just said, there's a need to discover the mechanisms of ALS to stop the disease. So we want to create specific lines of research, promote development of initiative ideas and projects, and we want to secure funding for the long term. So how do we do it? And the answer is collaborating. First, we develop a grant program, which is called Talento ELA. I tried to translate it in English, so maybe it makes more sense, but it's ALS Talent. And this is together with La Caixa Foundation. I will get into it really briefly later. And we just started this year also a program, a grant program, called Ayudas Un Zue Luzon. And this is in collaboration with the Carlos III Institute in Spain. So Talentoela is one project that lasts for 3 years, and it is of 500,000 euros. So this is a project inside La Caixa Health Research call for grants, and we put 125,000 euros. So we started this collaboration in 2017, thanks to the friendship between the director of La Caixa, well, the president of La Caixa, and the president of our foundation, Francisco Luzon. And we are committed to keep this collaboration, at least for sure, until 2027. But we really want to get funds to continue these lines of research at forever, let's say. So I'm showing you here all the projects that have that were the winners for the past years, the objective of their research, and some of the results that they are getting. Obviously, only the first ones are the ones getting more, let's say, publications, papers, and even the first one found a molecule that wants now to bring it to clinical trials. I won't talk about the projects in itself specifically because of the sake of time and the topic of the conference today, but if you guys have any questions, I will be really happy to talk about them later. And then Ayudas Un Zue Luzon, in this case, we are going to fund 4 projects every year. Each is going to also have a duration of 3 years, and it's going to be between 100,000 and 160,000 euros, and we fully pay for it. And this is thanks to Juan Carlos Unzue, who is there in the right corner. He helped us, well, he was the promoter of a charity soccer game that happened last year between Barcelona and Manchester City. So we got these funds for basic research, for this grant program, and also for clinical trials that I will talk about later. And again, these are the winners of this year. And as you can see, in this case, there's not only one person, but several people in some of the projects. And this is because we wanted to promote collaboration between different researchers. So they had to make collaborations to get more points to get the grant. So at the end, programs like this, like Talentoela and Ayudas Un Zue Luzon, at the end generates patents, publications, and it increases the interest of researchers on ALS. And this is going to get us faster to hopefully find the cure. But we not only give money, we also support our researchers. So when we first went to the International ALS Congress that happened in Spain in 2016, the scientists told us that there was a need for connection between Spanish ALS researchers. There were not that many, and they were spread out all around the country. So they needed to get connected. So we encouraged discussions and collaborations between different groups. So how do we do it? Well, we have different ways. One is we organize the virtual meetings that happen every month or two. And in those meetings, what we want is that they get to know each other. So they present their labs, the objective, materials and methods that they are developing, the results that they are getting, if they are having any problems, how to solve it. We also take care of the communication platform. So we use Slack, and they're the same. They can share the results, the way they are doing things. Also, we share some funding opportunities that they may be interested in. And we also take care of the database. So each of them, all the groups, gives us their information, and we also share them with them so they know if they need something, who to contact and who to go with. And it's thanks to these platforms that, for example, the three ladies that you see in the image, Valle, Estela, and Monica Povedano, they started a collaboration that actually this year was part of that collaboration, gave the grant, one of the grants, the winner of one of the grants. So we also support clinical research. We saw that there's a need to increase the chances to get in a clinical trial in Spain. So we want to promote development of clinical trials and sites. So for these, we collaborate with TRICALS in different ways. So first, we are the only TRICAL liaisons in Spain. And this brings us together with the TRICALS board and also with other TRICALS liaisons. So we are in contact with other countries, other initiatives, what they do, what they need, the way we do things, how they do it, so we can share and be helpful to each other. But we also give funds for clinical trial. In 2021, we started giving funds for the MagNet study, and also thanks to Juan Carlos Unzué, because of the charity game that I mentioned before, we are also giving funds to the Lighthouse 2 study that was actually approved by the Spanish agency like a week or two ago. So at the end, it's the same. Increasing the funds increases the interest of researchers in these studies, and therefore it increases the possibility to be recruited in a clinical trial. We also promote ALS patient registries. So there's a need of understanding the clinical and the socioeconomical situation of ALS patients, and especially in Spain, because there's almost no information about this. Because there's no national registry. So we need to promote the ALS Spanish, and we also promote the European registry. And in the same way, we also collaborate with TRICALS, and in this case also with the Carlos III Health Institute, and thanks to the funds raised by the game and also some collaborators from Juan Carlos Unzué. We also participate in scientific conferences, and not only participate by actively giving talks, but also organizing scientific conferences, events, workshops, and so we are members of different societies. So in the ALS community, we really need to be all connected because we are stronger together, as we always say. So we want to bring together patients, scientists, doctors, journalists, pharmaceutical companies, payers, politicians, and this way we can all share information and advice and support. So in this sense, we organize international scientific conferences like CINCELA and also the International Meeting on ALS together with Fundación Ramón Areces, which is also another Spanish foundation. We give workshops like clinical trials or drug development and regulation workshops. And we participate in different events, like the one we are here today, also as Jesco, ASEM Forum, and also some workshops organized by the European Medicines Agency. And we are also members of different society, like EUPALS, TRICALS, Patient Organizations Platform. Finally, we also give advice, information, and support. There's a need to answer questions and to help solve problems. We here all know that we face many problems in the ALS world. So we really need to be transparent and disseminate science, information, support, especially those who need it, and especially people living with ALS. So for this, we have our website where we usually update scientific content. We also respond to emails and also phone calls, and we participate in different events in case people have questions and we want to share also information. And in that sense, for you as well, if you have any questions, don't hesitate in contacting us. This is my email address and my phone number, but we are going to be here this weekend. It's going to be me, the president and the director of the foundation, who are sitting there with me. So feel free to ask any of us any question. Thank you.
Thank you, Raquel. So, do we have any questions for Raquel? The live chat or around there? David.
Hi. Actually, never introduced myself. I'm David with David Taylor with Alice Canada. I had a question about, you have a Slack group for the basic researchers. Mm-hmm. What's the uptake on that? Are they using it actively, or do you have to kind of push them to do it, or is it?
That's actually a great question. At the beginning, I thought they were not using it and that I was the only one posting things for nothing. But actually, I was really surprised that some of the things that I was posting, they were replying and they were really interested in, oh, I saw that you posted this call, can you please help me? Or even some papers, they were the ones actually posting them and starting a discussion about them. But they are, I would say they are more active in the meetings rather than on Slack. But it's working well. At the beginning, it was really slow to make them work.
Thank
but,
you.
But yeah.
Appreciate that.
We have one question here.
Hello, yes. It's Rick Nelms again from the UK. Really just building the registry in Spain, it's such a great idea, and also spreading it across Europe where, in the parts where it doesn't exist. And it's really just, how do we take that out into the rest of the world? Especially, how do we take it out into the really difficult places like Nicaragua and Angola and Yemen, for example?
No, I really have to admit that it's been a nightmare. So we started with this, I would say, maybe even 2 years ago. We started talking to different institutions to see first the way to do it, because it's like, okay, do we start our own registry and we support it from the beginning? But then we thought this is not going to happen because it's, we don't want to duplicate efforts and do parallel things. So there was a registry in that it was not in all the country, in the whole country, but it had few patients there. So we started talking to the National Institute of Health because they were doing something similar to other diseases. And also there's, so we collaborate with Ciber, which is kind of more the online platform. And they already had different contracts with different hospitals. So in that sense, the paperwork was going to be much less. But we also talked to another part of the Health Institute, and they were also having their own registry, but it was, the data was just by patients. So we wanted that if it was for research, it needed to have a clinical part. So at the end, we decided to do it with this on more online platform, because at some point, there's a registry. Each hospital has their own database. So what we want is that that database is translated into the other database. And actually, what we are doing is also in collaboration with Tricals, we are using the database that is going to be used in the European registry. So that way, it's going to be easier later on to also move it to the European one. But it's definitely a nightmare. Like, we had to talk to many, many people, and this is still our baby. So we are in the process of the contracts and all that, so we'll see how it works. But what basically all the clinicians said, that they don't have a lot of time, but they are really interested in the results from this, so they would like to collaborate. So as long as it has maybe not 100 variables, but maybe the minimum ones to do a little research, let's say, they will be interested in even their own, by themselves, to just change these variables from their own database to the bigger one. But we still needed money to hire someone who is going to help in the process, because I guess it's not going to be easy. It's also a platform that it's already installed in all the hospitals, so it's not super unfamiliar to them. But it's definitely hard work.
Okay, thanks. That's really, really interesting and obviously challenging.
Yeah, it's really challenging.
Okay, thank you. I think I have one more minute for probably one more question. Anyone else? Any other question for Raquel?
We got a question from Asper Karalaipa from the Hellenic ALS Association. Can you give us a link to the European platform?
The European platform for the European registry?
I believe so.
Okay, so I don't think it's out yet. It's Tricals, the one that is developing this together with Precision ALS. So they are developing all these variables and all these data sets to see and to collect data first from 9 sites from different places in Europe, but I guess that it's still not available.
Okay, thank you.
So many of the things that I brought here today, especially the registries, are really babies. So we are just starting and giving just the walking the first steps.
Okay, so please join me in thanking Raquel for that excellent presentation. Thank you, Raquel. Okay, so up next, please welcome Susan Webster with her presentation, Influencing Scotland's New Social Security System for People with MND. Thank you, Susan.
Hi, my name is Susan Webster, and I'm the Head of Policy and Campaigns at MND Scotland. I'll discuss today how MND Scotland influenced the development of Scotland's new social security system for the benefit of people with MND. From 2017 until the summer of last year, MND Scotland successfully ensured that all people with MND in the country would be fast-tracked for government financial support, without face-to-face assessment and at the highest amount payable. I'll go on to explain that we achieved this by influencing and mobilising the Scottish Government, MSPs, civil servants, third sector, clinicians, the media, and of course, people affected by MND. So as we all know, MND progresses incredibly quickly. Yet MND Scotland's financial support team found that people with the illness were waiting far too long to receive their Social Security disability benefits. This was because legislation, the UK Welfare Reform Act 2012, stated that people with a terminal illness should only be fast-tracked for these benefits if they could prove they had just 6 months left to live. However, many people with MND were not being fast-tracked for the benefits because the unpredictable nature of MND meant that clinicians could not be sure when they were in the last 6 months of life. Many clinicians were reluctant to sign off the necessary government forms, and some of those who did found themselves quizzed about their medical opinion by Social Security staff. In fact, research showed that 90% of those who were fast-tracked had a cancer diagnosis because the last 6 months of life was much easier to predict. This meant that many people with MND found themselves battling for the financial support they were entitled to, with some tragically dying before they received it. In 2013, 10 years ago, we lobbied the UK government to try to get them to improve the situation, but unfortunately, we were unsuccessful. So an opportunity presented itself to us just a few years later. Devolution in Scotland began almost 25 years ago and allowed the new Scottish Government to legislate in many important areas such as health, housing and education. However, following the unsuccessful 2014 Scottish independence referendum, in 2016 a number of other areas were devolved from the UK to the Scottish Government, including the disability benefits people with MND were failing to be fast-tracked for. New legislation would be necessary to transfer these powers to Scotland, and we knew that this presented us with a unique opportunity to improve the situation for people with MND in Scotland trying to access disability benefits. In 2017, the Scottish Government introduced to the Scottish Parliament its draft legislation, the Social Security Scotland Bill. We were disappointed to see no mention of fast-tracking terminally ill people. We had been expecting to see this because it had been included in the UK's Welfare Reform Act. Colleagues from another charity, Marie Curie Scotland, who support people with all terminal illness, shared our view on this. Working in partnership with them from that point, it soon became clear that the Scottish Government wanted to keep the problematic six-month rule. The reason given for this was that the Scottish Government wanted to ensure a smooth transition from the UK Government's social security system to Scotland's new system. Both our charities believed that this approach had no place in a new system, which was promoted to be based on fairness, dignity and respect. So together, we set out to ensure that a fair definition of terminal illness for social security purposes, based on clinical judgment rather than life expectancy, was included on the face of the bill to protect the people that we supported. As the bill started to work its way through Parliament, we met with the Scottish Government Minister responsible, but she was not for changing her mind. However, at that time, the Scottish Government was a minority government, so we knew there was an opportunity to influence opposition MSPs. In particular, we worked with the MSPs on the Social Security Committee of the Scottish Parliament, whose role it was to scrutinise the draft bill. We made sure the issue was highlighted in their initial committee report. Opposition MSPs were in a slight majority on the committee. One MSP was prepared to lodge an amendment to the draft legislation, defining terminal illness as 2 years life expectancy. We had wanted no reference to life expectancy at all, but as this was a significant improvement from 6 months, we agreed. This amendment was passed by the committee, despite the minister calling on them to vote against it. However, unfortunately, the government introduced a counter-amendment to the legislation, defining terminal illness as the last 6 months of life. Continuing to work with the government and opposition MSPs as the bill progressed through Parliament, we sought to secure support from a wide spectrum of others, using a range of public affairs and PR tactics. These included clinicians. We drafted a public letter of support for our position, which received 60 signatures from prominent clinicians, professors, academics and GPs. We planned media activity around our letter of clinician support and timed this to coincide with the government's publication of its amendments and clinical evidence. We offered our letter as an exclusive to the Times Scotland newspaper, achieving front page and editorial coverage. We went on to secure broad media coverage, including newspapers, TV, radio and social media. From the beginning, we secured the support of 19 key third sector organisations, including many health and rights-based charities who added their logos to our parliamentary briefings and shared our social media posts. We launched a direct action public engagement campaign at the same time as our media activity. We reached out to both charity supporters, asking them to email their MSPs to support our call for a fair definition of terminal illness to be included on the bill. Over 3,000 emails were sent to all 129 MSPs in just 24 hours from our supporters. And we promoted it extensively on social media. At the same time, we continued to work with MSPs and the Scottish Government. We spoke with the Scottish Government bill team to discuss the issue and what could be done to change it ahead of the final parliamentary debate and vote. The leader of the opposition raised the issue for us at First Minister's questions, and the First Minister replied that the Scottish Government was considering the issue. At risk of losing the vote, the Scottish Government introduced a final amendment with a definition of terminal illness based on clinical judgment, with no reference to life expectancy, what we had campaigned for at the beginning. The bill passed unanimously on the 25th of April 2018. However, much work remained to be done to ensure that what had been secured in legislation was delivered for people with MND in practice. The Scottish Government asked the country's chief medical officer to produce guidance for clinicians who would be required to follow this new legislation and fast-track terminally ill people for their social security benefits. MND Scotland and Marie Curie were invited onto a multidisciplinary working group of clinicians, charities and civil servants to help produce the guidelines. This, however, was not a smooth process, as not all civil servants welcomed the legislative change. However, working together for many months, we produced clinical guidance which everyone was happy with, and this was published in 2021. The CNO's guidance then had to be put into practice. We were included in the Scottish Government's National Implementation Group on Terminal Illness, which was set up to implement the guidance effectively. This working group included the new agency, Social Security Scotland, clinicians, charities and civil servants. These were new disability benefits, so complex processes had to be put in place for the agency staff delivering them, as well as the clinicians completing the medical forms. It was particularly complex because some Social Security benefits people with MND would claim were still delivered by the UK's Department for Work and Pensions, so it was critical that the two systems worked well together. All of this was hugely important, not just for people with MND, but our own organisation's financial support team, who has helped those with the illness to access the benefits they were entitled to from both agencies. In 2022, adult disability benefit, which would be claimed by most people with MND in Scotland, was tested in a number of pilot areas across the country. The effectiveness of the new Chief Medical Officer's guidance would be assessed alongside this. Then, in the summer of 2022, adult disability payment was rolled out right across Scotland. Finally, people with MND and other terminal illnesses would be fast-tracked for their benefit without face-to-face assessment and at the highest amount payable. So ultimately, the biggest impact of all this change is that people with MND and their loved ones are no longer fighting for the financial support they're entitled to. Importantly, clinicians are no longer quizzed about their medical opinion by Social Security staff, meaning they can have the confidence to sign the necessary forms, knowing they're not going to have to justify their decision to agency staff further down the line. MND Scotland continues to campaign on behalf of people affected by MND to ensure they get not just financial, but all the support they're entitled to, without delay, so they can spend the precious time they have left making memories with loved ones. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan, for that excellent presentation. And I believe she's listening. Yes, there she is. Okay.
Hi.
Hi, Susan. I will open the floor again for questions from the audience. We have one here, Gethin.
Thank you. Gethin Thomas from MND Australia. That's a fantastic result for advocacy there. Were there any conditions imposed upon the forms of MND, or was it had to be ALS, or did it include even people with slower progressing forms?
No, it was all people with MND. In fact, it was really a win for people with all terminal illness. So it was terminal illness that was included in the legislation rather than MND specifically. So that was the main reason that we worked with Marie Curie, because they cover all. So whilst, as I mentioned, that some people with terminal illness, some terminal illnesses were automatically fast-tracked, people with MND tended not to be. So that was the key change for us. But as I say, no, there was no specifications in terms of types of MND at all. Basically, at the end of the day, if you're clinician decided that you were terminally ill, you would be automatically fast-tracked. That's all you needed. There wasn't any qualifications associated with it.
Okay, so the qualification was, it wasn't that you had MND, is that the clinician says your disease is terminal?
That's correct, okay. Yes.
Cool. Thank you.
So we still have time. Do we have more questions? Kathy?
Susan, quick question for you. If you were going through the process all over again, is there anything you would do differently?
Oh, what a good question. I'm not sure that I would, actually. Which maybe sounds a bit vain, but...
Everything was perfect.
It was one of probably in other areas of work, there's things I would do differently, but that just, I think there was a lot of strength in working in partnership, and I can't really kind of overemphasize that, to be honest, because it just gave you the confidence from the beginning to the end that you were doing the right thing, because you kind of had each other's support. So to be honest, I don't know if there is anything that we did differently. I think we threw absolutely everything at it, particularly in the latter stages. As it went through Parliament, it went incredibly, incredibly fast. So it was really almost like a 24/7 campaign in the latter stages. We were just working on it all the time, relentlessly. And we couldn't take our eye off the ball as well. We just had to be massively on top of it in terms of what the government was doing, but also covering all of our bases with MSPs, the media, our supporters, the clinicians, everybody. So probably not. No, I don't think there is actually anything that we would do differently. But good question.
Do we have any other question for Susan? That's it. Okay. Thank you, Susan, for that excellent presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. We're doing well on time. Okay. Up next, we have Project Euphonia from Jimmy Tobin and Alicia Martin. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Alicia Martin, and I'm a program manager at Google. Presenting with me is Jimmy Tobin, a researcher and software engineer at Google. We're very excited to talk to you about some of the incredible research that our team is doing to support individuals with non-standard speech be better understood. And so today, a lot of the speech recognition technology relies on a lot of training data in order to work. Unfortunately, a lot of that training data comes from individuals or users with standard speech. And so for the 250 million people worldwide who have non-standard speech, a lot of the speech recognition technology or voice-activated technologies may not work well for them. And so in 2018, Project Euphonia was launched. We decided to launch Project Euphonia in partnership with the ALS Therapy Development Institute for the purpose of research and research that supports individuals with non-standard speech. This trusted tester program allowed us to gather some feedback on early prototypes. And then in 2019, we decided to make this program more broadly available to anyone that qualifies. The way that it works is that anyone with a mobile phone, tablet, or computer can access Project Euphonia, a web-based audio tool, in order to start recording phrases. We ask participants to record anywhere between 300 to 1300 phrases, depending on the language. And these phrases are typically in categories. These are two of the categories of phrases that we ask participants to record, which are typically corresponding to key use cases. One of these categories is how individuals interact with technology. So for example, if I'm having a conversation with a Google Home or Google Assistant, asking Google Assistant to stop the music. The other category of phrases is how individuals interact with other people. These are conversational phrases. And so, for example, if I were to be speaking to a caregiver and I ask the caregiver to turn on the TV for me. It's because of the many contributions from our trusted testers and all of these organizations who've contributed to Project Euphonia that we've been able to do some transcending research to support individuals with non-standard speech. And today, we're incredibly excited to announce that we're expanding our data collection efforts to more languages, including Spanish. There are over 400 million Spanish speakers worldwide. Spanish is also considered to be the second largest language in the United States with over 33 million speakers. For this reason, we've decided to partner with several organizations in Latin America to make technology more inclusive for users, including the International Alliance of ALS. And so in the next presentation, Jimmy Tobin will talk to you about some of that research to help individuals be better understood.
So previously we've presented work on adapting end-to-end speech recognition models, particularly RNNT models that are recurrent neural network transducer models, which are the ones that can run on your device, your phone or your tablet. What they do is they take audio waveform, just the recording of your voice, turn it into some visual representation, such as a spectrogram, and then send that to the encoder. And the encoder then uses that as the input signal, and also uses the context from previously transcribed tokens and combines those two signals to then predict the next token or word in the sequence. So that is what runs on your device right now. And for individuals with, let's say, dysarthria, what we found to be the best recipe to make those models work particularly for one individual is to tune and adapt just the encoder portion of this model using a relatively small amount of data. So we've taken a pre-trained model, which is around, trained with, hundreds of thousands of hours of speech data from several, thousands of participants. And then only tuning just the encoder portion for one speaker using maybe 20 minutes of speech data can yield very, very pronounced results and improvement in accuracy. Through feedback from the Trusted Tester program in Project Euphonia and from users of Project Relate, we found that there are certain limitations to that personalization recipe. Particularly one is not intelligibility is not a constant, especially for individuals with degenerative diseases such as ALS. So as you can see here, we have on the right, we have speech decline in bulbar onset ALS. And as see the around 9.4% per month in intelligibility decline. So that makes it difficult because when you train with data that at one level of intelligibility and then intelligibility degrades, then that makes the model less accurate on where you are now. So we have presented research on mitigation strategies for that. So be sure to check out that. Other issues are for some users, recording 20 minutes of speech data is not inconsequential. It can be almost intractable for certain people. So we wanted to be mindful of that. And we know that ideally, this should just all work out of the box and not require any intervention from a user. So that is what I'm presenting today is a step towards that. And then finally, as we've said before, this data what we've collected is all users reading prompts. And though that may be helpful, especially in situations where you're talking to a virtual assistant or where things are more structured in real conversation, things are much less structured. And we wanted to make sure that whatever we train is useful in many contexts, not just having short transactional phrases, either with technology or with other people. So to address this limitations that we found from personalization, the Euphonia research team, we shifted our focus from personalization to speaker-independent ASR, or as we'll say later in the slides, SIASR, which is basically trying to not focus necessarily on improving speech recognition for one user, but for all users at the same time. So out of the box, they'll be able to use and benefit from speech recognition technologies, no matter their level of dysarthria or how typical their speech is. So to that effect, we had to kind of come up with two strategies. One, we needed to find a data set, which we already had, but basically ensure that the data that we trained with was sufficiently large and specifically diverse and representative of the many etiologies that we've collected so far. Because as I said before, these models that we are adapting have already been trained with hundreds of thousands of hours of speech data from primarily from people with typical speech. And so we wanted to make sure that we also have, you know, a large and diverse data set to adapt with. And we also wanted to test and make sure that our models are working for the use cases that individuals will use speech recognition for. So not just for, you know, talking to a virtual assistant or having transactional phrases, but actual and real conversation. So I will go into that now. So taking the large Euphonia data set, we wanted to basically create a training portion and a test portion where there was no overlap between either any speakers or any phrases. What we didn't want to happen was that we thought that a model was getting very, very, very good, but then it turned out that it was just learning how one particular speaker was speaking, or it was just learning one particular phrase. So it's very important to have no overlap there. And also we wanted to make sure that we were utilizing as much of the data as possible, just because when you start slicing and dicing, some data will be left out. And we wanted to work to make sure that we were achieving our goals where we were using a large and diverse data set for training, and also testing on a large enough and diverse enough representative test set. So that's what we ended up with, are the stats shown in this slide. So our test data is 200 speakers and around 5,700 utterances, and our training data is 1,200 speakers with almost a million utterances. And then there's a small portion of around 350 utterances from 24 speakers that we can just use basically to track how well the model is doing as it's training, which we call dev data. So, you know, check out the blog post here, and there will be a QR code at the end to understand more about this. We also created a real conversation test set. So this data is unprompted and spontaneous speech that our trusted testers recorded using in real-world usage of a personalized ASR model. We worked with these trusted testers to record them speaking, and then speech-language pathologists reviewed all the data, removed any personally identifiable information, and then transcribed it. So this data set is this is 29 speakers and around 1,500 utterances that we can then use to measure how well our models are doing in real-world conversation. So here are the results of fine-tuning USM with our data set. You can see USM's word error rate as the red bar in the middle of the two clusters. On the left, you see our prompted speech word error rate going from red, which is USM, adapting is the yellow bar. We can see accuracy is improved by 32% on prompted speech and 44% on conversational speech. The blue bar is a previous model trained with YouTube data, and it's there just to show what a smaller model that's not 2 billion parameters, just the effect of a model growing in size can have. And so what we're seeing is that, you know, this is a large win because it's a model that's more accurate for individuals with atypical speech, and it required no recording by one particular individual. It just worked better out of the box. However, if the model is still not serving a particular individual, we still say that personalization to one person's voice is will be the best chance of having a speech recognition model recognize that particular person. So here's a couple examples of a trusted tester speaking extemporaneously and the different models' predictions of what was said. So we have the ground truth, which was what was actually said, and then the different models' predictions. So let's start with the first one.
I now have an F-pop and back and control mode on my map. I now have an F-pop and back and control mode on my map.
So we can see the L and the M in the fine-tuned LSM is USM is able to differentiate a little bit better, but they're very close. And then the second one.
On the top of the flight model now. On the top of the flight model now.
And here is something that is very typical for models that haven't been trained with any atypical speeches. They just truncate and don't recognize or transcribe any speech it doesn't recognize. So as you can see, only the fine-tuned USM was able to transcribe I've been talking for in this space. But again, both truncate on let's see. So there's more work to be done. But as we can see in the data here and in the previous slide, there is a significant lift in accuracy. Thank you very much. Full details can be found in the blog post by following this QR code here.
Thank you very much, Jimmy and Alicia. So we are ready for questions now. Any questions? Gethin, one question here.
Gethin Thomas, MND Australia. Thank you for that. So the last conclusion was there's still a bit more work to do. How are you going to do that, or how much work is there more to do on this? Is it just putting more and more data through it so it gets better at learning, or is there a different approach you need to do?
Thank you for the question. Yeah, so I think there's a couple things that we really are interested in. One is English is great, and we love English. But people speak other languages, and this USM universal speech model is able to recognize 100 languages. So, getting better at those languages it requires data. So, getting better at English will require more data. Getting better at other languages as well. There's three things I want to talk about. Two would be specifically, making sure that it's not just, American English that we are targeting, and that we are making, collecting representative data sets and representative words that are important to different communities. So I believe Richard Cave has spoken earlier at this event, and he's done a lot of great work in Ghana and collecting data there and collecting feedback about how these models work and how there needs to be improvement for the phrase sets there that we use. And I had a third one, and it is, what I showed was some bar charts of word error rate. And that is basically about, how perfectly is that speech model transcribing exactly what you have said. But through feedback from working with people with ALS and MND and other neurological conditions, just being understood, being comprehensible is more important than exactly getting it exactly right, especially when you're in a conversation and the goal is just to be understood. So we're working and have published work on how to evaluate these speech models for comprehensibility rather than syntactic accuracy so that's kind of what we're working on and the next steps. Thank you.
Okay, I believe we have two more questions. Jen?
Can I remove the "na" in her speech?
Can I do the "sneda" speech? Can it remove the snap in the speech? Can it remove the snap in the speech?
The snap in the speech?
Snap.
Slur. Yeah.
The slur.
The slur.
Oh, sure. So this is a recognition model, and just for transcription. So it's not transforming or playing back anything such as the repeat function in Project Relate. The purpose of this is to listen to the speech and transcribe it whether or not there is slur present. But there are other technologies that other teammates on my team are working on for voice transfer or the repeat function in Relate. I hope that answers your question.
It did? Yes. Okay. I have one more question here from Marcela.
Well, this is basically Marcela from Marcela, Colombia. This is just basically a comment. We started working with you guys to get people from Spanish speaking to start recording their voices. And it's been amazing. Patients are really happy because usually we don't have voice banking in Colombia, first of all. So usually when we talk with the patients that already have dysartria, they're like, there's nothing we can do. In this case, there's nothing they can do for themselves, but they know they're pitching in for a future patient with ALS. They will be understood in future years thanks to this type of technology. So this is just a thank you for thinking in Spanish-speaking patients, and just like everybody work together so we can actually improve lives and quality of life of patients with ALS all over the world. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I've been on the team for 5 years now, so this is a important thing to work on. Thank you.
We still have time for a couple of more questions. We don't? Oh, okay. Okay, thanks again, Jimmy. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, so for our final presentation of the day, we have the life of a female ALS patient in Japan with Hitomi Hasebe and Katsushi Tamaki. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm all like,
だから重度訪問介護を入れていかなきゃいけないって、で時間数もらわなきゃいけないっていうとこですね。
ヘルパーさんの事業所がやっぱりないってないということですよね、重訪のね。だいたい地方はそうなんですね。
ですってもう分かるんですよ。私が残念ながら器用じゃないので性別が違うので、どうしてもそのメイクのことだったりとか体のことだったりとか分かんない部分が多いので、それで近いられないっていうのはすごく悔しかったですね。私なりにはやってるつもりなんですが、なかなか求めてるレベルに程遠い。
Final presentation is my load. Phew. And Ms. Hasebe and I came from Japan, and we are a director of Japan AIDS Association. And we already introduced the film, and Motoko Ogasawara was diagnosed with AIDS 2018. From that, she is always struggling to live with ALS and his partner, her partner. And before we came here, Basel, I asked her one question. What is the dream of your life? He answered, is managing the facility for the disability, including ALS patient and challenged. She has a big dream, I think so that. That's all, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Hitami and Katsushi. We do have time for questions. Any questions for them? We have people crying here. That's one thing I can say, yeah.
It's not a question so much. I'm Sue Nelms from the UK, full-time carer for my husband who has MND. Just to say that I thought that their relationship was beautiful. I think the love and care that's shown by her man, it was just wonderful. And she's got such humour and positivity. And I don't think it matters that he doesn't know anything about makeup. I think that she loves him for all the care that he gives her. So I hope that you will please sort of tell them just how much they moved everybody here today.
Thank you very much for a wonderful comment.
That was really nice. We have a couple of more questions.
Thank you very much for that very moving and very real presentation. I'm curious, when people are in rural areas, are there ways for people to connect? Are there support groups or Zoom groups? I heard about nursing care and physical care and then her partner. But are there other ways that someone clearly having lots of emotions can be supported in your system?
We have the AIDS Association in the each prefecture. And sometimes they will support them, and sometimes a patient asked me how to leave after then. And we always support them from the various angle. Okay.
I believe there was more question over there in that area. Gujin.
Is there a difference in getting help if you go on ventilation or not? How is it with when you go on track? Is it easier to get help?
Excuse me, I can't understand what you said.
Let me rephrase. If you need help in Japan, you ask for help and you need a breathing machine. Is it easier to get help than if you do not need the truck?
Your question is how the patient call the someone to help?
Especially if they need ventilation, especially if they need machine, for example.
Is it
easy to get that help, that assistance, or not?
In this condition, heart condition, she can ask the help now, using a computer. Eye contact.
Or also help from nurses or other health professionals to help her with her respiratory condition.
Deep question. Called cookie.
So I believe the question is how is the support in that cases?
Yeah, in those cases. Yes. Yeah, I think it is easy if he patient wears a respirator.
So it is easier, apparently. Do we have any more questions? I believe not. There was one there. No? Okay. Thanks again, Hitomi and Katsushi.
Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, before we wrap up, I would like to invite Kathy Cummings and Yohei Yamada, who will share some words. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I have the privilege of reading some remarks from Yohei, just to make sure that the electronics work in terms of being able to convey his remarks. Yohei has wanted to tell everyone that he's flown also from Japan, along with our last presenters, to meet every one of you ladies and gentlemen today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Yohei Yamada, and I'm a green bean to the board of directors, as I've joined the team a year ago. I've been living with ALS for 10 years, and I'm living with a gorgeous wife and three growing children who are with me today. Over the years, I've experienced ups and downs, but whenever problems come up, I have overcome any difficulties like conquering stages of Super Mario Brothers. Being diagnosed with ALS is unfortunate, but I don't have time for being pessimistic about the disease, as I have millions of other things to worry about. My minor disability will not stop me from staying active, and I will not let ALS control my life. I have traveled 13,000 kilometers for this meeting. With my 20 of diehard employees, I can virtually do everything. Stay strong, my fellow ALS fighters worldwide. It won't be long before a cure is discovered. Until then, International Alliance is going to continue to do everything to support our friends with ALS. Thank you, Yohei Yamada.
Thank you, Yohei, and thank you, Kathy, too. Okay, so this is the end of day one. Thank you for having me as a moderator of this session, number four of today's part of our meeting. Don't leave yet. For those of you here with us in person, please join us for the fun night, which begins now in the Topaz Room on the second floor. That's four levels up, I believe. Okay, so we encourage you to wear a t-shirt representing your association or country, and we will also have a swag swap there, okay, where each member association can share their promotional products, giveaways, or branded goods. And that's not all, because as you heard earlier, we will have the premiere of Lucky and the Lights, a touching short film to create awareness of ALS-MND and help children understand what it is. A variety of refreshments will be served, and a cash bar will be available. Therefore, everyone, whether in person or not, please join us back here tomorrow at 9 a.m. It's not going to be as early as today. It's going to be a little bit later, 9 a.m. for the second day of the Alliance meeting. And remember, all sessions will be recorded and available to view after the event if you have to miss anything. Thank you for joining us today, and I will see you tomorrow. Thank you.